Wonderful. In the Lord, we form a body. And when a body unites together, leprosy is when body parts die. And that's why lepers can lose their fingers, their toes, sometimes their noses. And we need to understand that God places us as a body for a purpose. Just declare that with me. Thank you, Father, that you make us a body and that you unite us together. Lord, individually we strong, but united we unconquerable. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Let's give the Lord a praise offering.
Yeah. Cause all that you are is all that we want. We're running. Because of you I freely live, my life to you, O God, I give. So I stand before you, God. I lift my voice, 'cause you set me free. So I shout out your name.
Affection that whispers of his heart and passion, it's pouring down. His love is deep, his love is wide, and it covers us. love is fierce, His love is strong, it is furious.
His love is sweet, His love is wild,
and it's waking us to life. The Father loves and sends His Son. The Son lays down His life for all. His love upon us, He calls us now, His sons and daughters, He's reaching out. His love is deep, His love is wide, and it covers us. His love is fierce, His love is strong, it is furious. His love is sweet, His love is wild, and it's waking hearts to life. His love is deep, His love is wide, fierce, His love is strong and it's furious. His love is sweet, His love is wild, and it's waking us to life. Waking us to life. Waking us to life. Nothing can tear us. Nothing can tear us from the grip of His mighty love. We've only glimpsed His vast affection that whispers of His heart and passion. It's pouring down. His love is deep, His love is wide, and it covers us. His love is fierce, His love is strong, and it's furious. His love is sweet, His love is wild, and it's waking hearts to life. The Father loves and sends His Son. The Son lays down His life for all. He lavishes His love upon us, He calls us. His love is wide and it covers us. His love is fierce, His love is strong, it is furious. His love is sweet, His love is wild, and it's waking hearts to life. His love is deep, His love is wide and it covers us. His love is fierce, His love is strong, it is furious. His love is sweet, His love is wild, and it's waking hearts.
More than the air I breathe.
song I see. More than the
hits I've been,
more than anything, and Lord, as time goes by, I'll be by your side. 'Cause I never want to go
the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone.
In your presence, Lord,
Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome here.
Come fly.
Glory, God, is what our hearts long for,
to be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Your presence, Lord.
Is nothing worth more than will ever come close. Nothing can compare your outliving hope.
your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of lives, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In the presence of the Lord,
Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome here.
Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be
raise their hand. I see that so clearly in the Spirit. Just raise your hand. Will people around you just lay hands on you? Just lay hands on you. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Just look at me for a moment. You've had a disappointment. And in that disappointment, it nearly broke your heart. I carried that burden 2,000 years ago. Give it to me. I'm the healer of broken hearts, and I'm the restorer of joy. As you let go, my presence, my glory will just come and fill you. Thank you, Lord. There it breaks right now. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Lord, we just honor you for your presence. We honor you for your presence. Welcome, precious Holy Spirit. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. You know, I just sense people who've had situations where you've been disappointed in somebody. You've got hurt. And it's like you get over it and then the thing comes back. I know it might be sensitive. Won't you just raise your hand for a moment? Will people around you just come and, I know perhaps it's strange, will you just give them a hug? Just give them a hug. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Take a moment and greet everybody around you. Thank you, Father. whenever we get together as a family, understand that the Holy Spirit wants to come and make whole. And He comes and He restores. So welcome to everybody here this morning. We can honor the Lord with that which is entrusted to us. Now thank you for a faithful congregation. You see, whether you give in cash or whether you give by debit card or whether you give by when you're at home alone and you pay in through internet, God comes and He honors you. I was sitting with a man in my office and he says how difficult it was when he began to serve the Lord. He said he'd walk with his offering to the church and he'd walk past the bakery and he'd be so hungry. He said he'd had his portion of food for the morning, but the smell of bread, everything turned in his stomach. And the thought came, take what you've got and buy bread, you're hungry. And he said, my Bible says, I will not live from bread alone, but from every word that comes from the mouth of God, out of Matthew 4:4. And he took the little bit and he gave it. And he says, today when he looks back, he knows that he learned obedience in that time. And today, where the Lord is first, He's blessed him exceptionally. He's doing phenomenally in business. But he says that was one of the biggest tests that he went through at that time. As we come to honor the Lord, Matthew 6:33, a promise that we have for this year with divine connections is seek first the kingdom of God. And I want to say His way of doing things, that's righteousness. And all these things will be added unto you. God cares for you. And He wants to bless you. Father, we thank You that we can pray Your blessing over every person's seed. And thank You, Lord. We know that this was born of You. So You will carry us through. In Jesus' precious name. Amen. The ushers can take up the offering. We just have a couple of announcements. Can we see who are first-time visitors with us today? Won't you just raise your hand? Just keep it there for a moment. Somebody's going to give you a card, and at the end of the service, at the back there, there's a visitor's lounge, and you're invited to come and have some coffee and a muffin, and I'd just like to share with you. And remember, on this side where the children's church is, under the tent, under the tarpaulin there, there's coffee available. So whenever you come early or afterwards, sometimes bring your lunch with a family group and fellowship over there. I just want to mention that the Israel tour this year will be in English and Afrikaans. So people who want to go with, I believe because we're in a rainbow nation that we should have a rainbow group together with us on tour. I really want to tell you that last time four of our ladies in the English congregation went with and they challenged many people and brought a change in their hearts at the end of the tour. Interesting thing that people said, I shared a room with the best roommate I've ever shared. That's wonderful to hear. Then on the 26th of March, we wanted to put it on the screen, but something broke there this morning. That's technology. On the 26th of March, Wednesday at 9 o'clock, we have a funky hat celebration. That means that 7 o'clock. What did I say? Sorry, 7 o'clock, Wednesday night. 7 to 8:15, we have a funky hat cell celebration to celebrate. And we all come together then, the English congregation, and it's not an English service, it's a congregation. We'll go to the chapel and then you'll just fix over there because we want to establish new cell groups and have people motivate one another. So if you will take note of that. Now, if you've got a funky hat, you bring the hat. From my days, people used to go to church with hats, and on them they had parrots and carrots. So put a carrot or a parrot on your hat and come that night and let's have a wonderful time. The children's church will be going as well, so you'll be able to leave your child over there. Wonderful. Praise the Lord. We've got Mayan Sobrine with us this morning. Some of you might not know Mayan, but you'll enjoy his testimony. Welcome, Mayan. He's a very precious brother. I've got a very soft spot for Mayan. Mayan was a Hindu, has become a Christian, but let's listen to his testimony. Mayan writes a couple of books, which he'll share with you, and God has began to open doors for him in the sporting world, and he's just finished in April the life story of Chad Leclos. I get mixed up with the name, will be on the racks. Welcome. Let's just extend our hands to Mayan. Father, thank you for your servant. Thank you that he blessed us in the first service. And thank you what you've done in his life. And Lord, that it will filter through and touch each one here this morning. In Jesus' name. We all said, amen.
Amen.
Thank you, my brother.
Thank you, Pastor Neville. Excellent. So good to be here this morning. Good morning. Excellent. I was born in Durban and immigrated to New Zealand in the year 2000. And as an Indian in South Africa, you're not regarded as being black. You're regarded as a half black. But because I've lived in New Zealand for 12 years, I'm now all black. So the Lord has completed the journey in my life. We've been there for 12 years and we're just back now for almost 2 years. And you know, I live in Pretoria with my family. And God hasn't taken us back to Durban. And people say to me, oh, you know, how is it? They're living in Pretoria. And I said, well, Pretoria is very nice because the airport is so nearby. Was it? No, not OR Tambo. No, not Lanseria. No, we use Waterkloof Air Base. Oh, sorry, that's just only for the Indian people. Yeah, my uncle's name is Gupta. So one of the benefits. But unfortunately, you guys got to drive all the way to Lanseria and OR, but nevertheless. This morning I'm here just to testify, and I believe there's power in a testimony. And you know, with a testimony, it's so important to remember that you can't have a testimony without the test, and then comes the money. You know, I mean, it's just joking. Sorry, that's the Indian in me. But in a testimony, you know, the great thing is that for me, growing up as a Hindu, you know, I didn't like it when people used to tell me about Jesus and stuff like that. I would always say to them, don't tell me about Jesus, show him to me. What has Jesus done for you? And that's the great thing about a testimony. You know, once I was lost, but now I'm found. Once I was blind, but now I see. And this is the amazing grace that God has for you and me. And that's the power of a testimony. You know, most people may not read a Bible, but they'll read your life. And how do you live your life? And I've written two books. These are the small books, Testimonies to Inspire with Rugby Players there, Pierce Spies, Gianni De Beer, Morne Stain. And there's just a little bit of our journey as a family, which I'll share with you today. I'm also on Facebook, so you can follow me on Facebook or Twitter as well. I normally send out my messages. I share a message twice a week on Radio Pulpit, Monday evenings at 20 past 5, and then Friday mornings at 7:35. They give me a call, and they ask me to share something current on the current news. And because I don't read the newspapers, well, actually, I read the newspaper, but I read mostly the back pages. I don't read the front pages. I choose not to listen to the news when I'm driving into work. I don't even watch the news. I read the news on the internet, you know, so I can click on what I want to read. All the other stuff, I don't want to filter that down through my mind and my body. Because I'm here in South Africa. I'm back in South Africa with a message. You know, I've written Pierce Spies' book, The Current Bulls. Captain, and people know, how is it that an Indian guy wrote Pierce books? So I tell them, a Boer maak 'n plan, but you need an Indian to sell it. So, and I've even written a book in Afrikaans, and it's not a translation. I've actually written it in Afrikaans, and because I studied Afrikaans in school. I mean, you guys know, we all studied Afrikaans from Standard 1 to Metric back in the day. And for me, the great thing is that, you know, God changed my perception. He changed my whole outlook on Afrikaans and rugby as well. Because as an Indian boyki growing up in Durban, you know, Afrikaans was not our language. Afrikaans for us was the taal of the oppressor, the language of the oppressor. And rugby was the sport of the oppressor. But in New Zealand, everything changed for me. I was asked to come to a marae, which is a New Zealand Maori meeting place. And on the marae, the leader asked me to bring a greeting that was not in English, from my mother tongue. And I said to him, I don't know any Indian languages. I only know Afrikaans. And they said, well, bring it in Afrikaans. And he said, and I said to him, no, you don't understand. Afrikaans is not our language. You know, it's the language of the oppressor. And I gave him the whole history of apartheid and all of that. And he listened. And then he said to me, but Mayan, the Bible says every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord. He says there's no evil in a language. And he says that's the misconception. That's a lie that you've been made to believe. And that day, that very moment, something broke over my life. I think it was a stronghold. And not only in Afrikaans, but also with rugby, because I brought the greeting in Afrikaans. And at the same time, for the first time in my life, I passed a rugby ball. It was because in New Zealand, everybody plays rugby. And at that camp that we were in, they played rugby. And I went on, you know, after that, from 2001, I spoke more Afrikaans in New Zealand than I ever did in South Africa, because every time I'd meet a South African person, I would speak to them in Afrikaans. And then rugby went on. You know, you'll hear a little bit more of what I'm going to share about how God opened doors for me through rugby. But my message in coming back to South Africa is to remind South Africans that the grass is not always greener on the other side. You know, we think that things are better overseas. And I want to encourage people, you know, if you haven't been overseas, go on a holiday. Before you decide to immigrate, you know, go on a holiday and go and see what it's like. Go to London and pay £5 for a cup of coffee. £5, you do the maths, is about 90 rand now. Go to France and pay 10 euros for a cup of coffee, about 150, 120 rand. You know, go and experience how hard it is to live there. And you know, most of your families and friends in overseas won't tell you about the tough times. They will always tell you, hey, come over. You know, and they will tell you about the bad news happening in South Africa. But they won't tell you what's happening there in overseas. You know, the first time my house got broken into was in 2004. Guess where it was? In New Zealand. The first time my wallet got stolen, guess where it was? In New Zealand. And I said, God, what's happening? And that's when God said to me, he said, Mayan, people need to understand that their safety and their security is not in a country. It's not in the hands of people. It's in my hands. And that's what we need to know. You know, again, if God hasn't called you to go overseas, then, you know, don't go. But talk to the leaders of your church, talk to senior people, and ask them to pray about it. Because I can assure you, you know, the same thing that you're running away from here is going to be at that side waiting for you. And that's what people don't understand. There's so many South Africans that are living overseas that I've met that are so disappointed, so teleurgesteld. I can't find any, yeah, disappointed. And I speak more in Afrikaans than in English, so please forgive me if I make a fault, I mean, a mistake. Surprising to hear that from an Indian guy from Durban. But the reality is that's what it is. There's South Africans that are living overseas that are upset because they want to come back to South Africa. They miss the good old days. And when I say to them, well, what's stopping you from coming back? Why don't you go? Ah, Mayan, well, what the people will say, man. Huh? They'll say, hey, bro, you left and you went. Now you're coming back. You know what that is? That is pride. That is pride. When my family heard that we're coming back to South Africa after living for 12 years in New Zealand, they said to me, you're mad. You got four daughters. You're bringing them to this crime-ridden country. There's so much of problems. You know, we got our problems. We've got our dilemmas and our malemas. But, you know, show me a country in this world that doesn't have problems. Show me a country. We need to understand there's not one country in this world that doesn't have its problems. And you go overseas and you experience what it is. Because, you see, the problem in South Africa is that our media, our press are very good at writing about bad things. They are very good at that. You know, in New Zealand and Australia, they censor the press. They censor the media in terms of what they can write about. New Zealand and Australia, maybe even England, there's rules that disallow newspapers from writing about people committing suicide. You won't read it in the newspapers. And guess which country has the highest rate of suicide in the world per capita of people? New Zealand. And Australia is not too far behind. In Europe as well. Why are they like that? You know how many South Africans I've met that go overseas and get depressed? I experience my number one prayer request when I go around New Zealand in prayer, asking people coming forward for prayer. Guess what's the number one request? Pray for me, Pastor, I'm depressed. I hear voices in my head telling me to kill myself. And what I'm saying is, and I'm not saying it's only in New Zealand or Australia, but my point is that overseas is a different kettle of fish altogether. In South Africa, we have the luxury of going to work and we can pray. You know, we can get together and we can have a Bible study. Overseas is not like that. You know, you can't just get together and pray in Jesus' name. They don't allow that. It's very, very difficult to do anything in Jesus' name in the most of the first world countries. But I'm back to make a difference, to encourage South Africans that God is not finished with South Africa. And you know what? The best lies ahead for our country. And I do that just by sharing a bit of my testimony and what I've gone through. I started off in business in South Africa at the age of 19, a long time ago. And I'm Indian, but people gave me a Chinese name. They started calling me Too Young. They said, "You're too young. What do you know about a business? You're too young." I didn't argue with them. I was too young. They said, "You don't know how to run a business." I said, "You're right. I don't know many things, but I know one thing. And that is, if I put my trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, He knows all things." And that's the difference. You see, I was brought up under this philosophy called karma. You'll have a look at my book called Born a Hindu, Die a Hindu. Those were the words that my mother said to me when I became a Christian. I came home and I was all excited. "Mom, I'm now a Christian." And, you know, and she said, "You're born a Hindu, you will die a Hindu." But you see, there's a difference. That has a question mark at the end. Because my same mother in 1994 that said, "I'm born a Hindu, I must die a Hindu," 6 years later, she gave her heart to the Lord. Amen. And if you want to know how, you've got to read the book. You've got to buy the book. The book is outside in the book. The book shop is on this side, I think. You got to, no, sorry, man. That's just the Indian in me. But it's a long story. It's a long story. It's a very long story. But in the book, I share about that. And I share about a philosophy called karma. You know, karma says a lot of things. And what we know karma to be, in a very short sense of it, is you do good, you get good. You do bad, you get bad. But the truth of the matter is, as a child of God, bad things happen to good people. That's just the way it is. And as a child of God, you choose not to believe in karma, but in Romans 8:28, that says all things work together for good to those who love the Lord and are called according to His purposes. And that's the truth, that God can take a negative situation or what we regard as being bad, and He can turn it around for our good. You know, karma says many things. I've just highlighted some of what it says in my book. It says that a person has to work out his own salvation. And that's what has happened. We've become a society that is so not theocentric, which is God-centered, but we've become a society that is so anthropocentric. Anthro is a fancy word for man. So we've become so man-centered that we build everything around ourselves, that we've got to have all the answers. We've got to have all the solutions to our problems. That's karma. Karma says that you are responsible for your own salvation. Karma says you got to find the answers yourself. And what happens when you hit a pothole? By the way, there's a lot of potholes around. Be careful as you drive. One of the benefits of coming back to South Africa, a lot of potholes on the road. But I say to people, no, friends in New Zealand, they say, how's South African roads? I said, no, we live on very holy roads. Very holy. And they go, wow, man, what? Everybody's on pilgrimage. I said, yes, every day we drive in South Africa, we're on pilgrimage on the holy roads. You're not going to get a negative thing out of me about South Africa. You know? So, this is what karma says. You know, karma says that you're trapped in your past. It says that you can't change your circumstances. That's it. But we have the key to unlocking that negative, that cage that people are in. We have the key to heaven by telling them that anyone that is in Christ is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, you are now a new creation, a new creature in Christ. And that's the message that we have. Because you see, when you have that mindset that you've got to solve all your problems, then it becomes your baby. Have you heard that expression? Hey, that's your baby. You deal with it. No, no, no. God gave His baby to us some 2,000 years ago. And He's now our Savior. He's our King. He's our Lion of Judah. And when you give Him your problems, you know, He takes care of us. And we no longer live in this karmic cycle that you do bad, you're going to get bad. And that's it. You're stuck in that rut. Now, when we cry out to God, He makes a way for us. You know, God really blessed me in the business. I was an insurance broker, an accountant, and I did really, really well. And people said, well, if things are so good, why did you leave South Africa? Very simply, I got held up at gunpoint, but don't worry, I survived. Life becomes pretty sobering when you're staring down the barrel of a 357 Magnum. Now, a 357 Magnum is not an ice cream. It's a big gun, okay? I know I'm back in South Africa because Pastor Neville, in New Zealand, when I tell people I was held up at gunpoint, they're like, they're very, very scared, you know, scared and shocked. But I see in South Africa, you're sitting there and you're saying, only one time, you know? So thank God there's only one time, you know, but anyway. And in New Zealand, I go there. When I got held up at gunpoint, you know, I thank God that I was no longer a Hindu. I was a child of God. And, you know, God spoke to me and I said, God, why did this happen? Because everything happens for a reason and a purpose. You know, there's no such thing as coincidence. If you're a child of God, you got to go to your dictionary and find the word coincidence and scratch it out. Because we don't believe in coincidence. We believe in God-appointed opportunity. God incidents. That's the difference. And God spoke to me and he laid on my heart and he said, sell up the business. I want you to go to New Zealand. And there I went and I studied to be a teacher in a theological institute there. And you know, when I got there, the plan was that I would put the sale of the business, I was going to sell the business and live off the interest. But when I got to New Zealand, the people that bought my business didn't pay me. And I'm there with my wife and my eight-month-old daughter, and there's no money. And I phoned my lawyer back in Durban, and I said, what do I do? And he said to me that you got to come back and all, you know. What are you laughing at? So he said, come back and all, and I said, no, man, it wasn't an easy decision to make. But I remembered in the Bible, in 1 John 2:1, it says that we got an advocate in Jesus Christ. And I asked the Lord, what do I do? And God gave me these words. Whatever I blessed you with in South Africa, forget it. I'm going to bless you anew. And people look at that and they say, wow, that's such a great faith to have. But I like to say, it's not about having a great faith. It's about having faith in a great God. You see, when you have great faith, where's the focus? On yourself. But when you have faith in a great God, it's on God. Because didn't Jesus say, faith the size of a mustard seed can move the mountain? And it's important to know that. And I go to New Zealand, and my first job, from having my own business in South Africa, from living a good life, house on the beach, driving a nice vehicle, people working for me, my first job is in a place called, like McDonald's, called Burger King. Now I see this Burger King, they followed me to South Africa, they opened up here. And I wasn't a director or a manager. No, I had to start right at the bottom, cleaning the floors and cleaning the toilets. But before I made the burgers, I washed my hands, all right? So don't be worried. But you know, that's one of the first lessons God had to teach me, going to New Zealand. Because the problem with our South Africans, I'm included there as well, is that we're too proud people. You know, the first toilet I cleaned was in New Zealand. The first floor that I cleaned was in New Zealand. Why? Because I had other people to do that for me. And you know, the thing is, going through that experience prepared me for where I am today. I realized that, I said to God, I said, God, why am I here? You know, in South Africa, I had so much money. I could write out a check. I could bless this ministry. I could sow into that mission. And now I've got no money. How can I serve you, God? And that's when God said to me, see, that's the problem with people. They think in order to serve me, I need money. No, I need your heart. Because when God's got your heart, then he's got everything. But you know, at the same time, I had every excuse not to give to God what was his. Because I was earning minimum wage in New Zealand. And I could have said to God, you know, God, you're okay, man. I don't have to give you what I'm supposed to give you. But I didn't do that. I made sure I still gave to God what was his. And I'm talking about our tithes. Because if you're not faithful in a little, how can God bless you with much? You know, how many of you want to be in a partnership where you get 90% and the other partner keeps only 10%? I want to be there. That's a partnership I want to be in. You know, and that's the reality of the partnership we're in with God, where everything is his. And they said, but no, you keep 90%. I'll just take 10%. And we even find that hard to do. And I made sure that I didn't do that. I didn't rob God. And you know, in doing that, now I find myself in the presence of, you know, people that we regard as well-known, you know, sports stars, and I'm in a position to motivate them and, you know, be a life coach to them and encourage them. And people get shocked. They're like, how is it this Indian guy from Durban is moving with the rugby circles, you know, the Springboks and the Lions or the Bulls or Sharks? And they can't understand how is it. So they ask me, what's your career history? So I said to him, well, I'm an accountant. I was an insurance broker. No. How many games of rugby have you played? And I go, zero. Nothing. Like I said, the only time I passed a rugby ball was in New Zealand. But I've never played in a rugby game at all. And they're amazed. But what's your qualifications? And you know what I say to them when they ask me what's my qualifications? I say to them, I clean floors and I clean toilets in New Zealand. And from there, God has given me the opportunities that I have now. Because if you're not faithful in the little, if you can't prove yourself to be loyal and faithful to God in cleaning floors and cleaning toilets, how is he going to bring you before great people? How can he trust you to speak the truth? You know, I had a coffee with Franz Ludeker, the Bulls head coach, before I spoke at Moreleta. In fact, he called me and he said he wants to speak to me before I speak at the NG Moreleta Daniel conference. And we're sitting, we're having coffee, and he says, "Man, you know, I know you now for a good time, about three, 4 years, because we met the Bulls in Auckland and stuff like that." And he says, "You know, I can see why God has called you back to South Africa." He says, "Because South Africans want to be told the truth. They don't want to be told it in this way and that way and another way." And he said, "I can see that God has raised you up to speak the truth and speak it in love. And I want you to know that when you stand in front of these burkis, you speak straight to them because that's what they like." That was for NG Moreleta. But I'm telling you that God wants to raise up a standard in South Africa, a standard that is true to him, true to his word. Don't worry about what the BL says or the Sunday Star or the other newspapers. You worry about what God's word says. You know, you either align yourself with the 10 spies that said there's giants there, we got no chance, or you align yourself with what Joshua and Caleb said. Yes, there's giants. Yes, there's problems. But because God said it, we were well able to do it. And I'm in New Zealand and, you know, I have to learn this lesson that your work does not define who you are. The job that you do does not define who you are. Your job is only a means to serve God. And I said, maybe there's people that are going to eat these burgers that don't know the Lord. Maybe they need a blessing. So I said, let me pray over the burgers. Father, bless the people eating these burgers in Jesus' name. Touch them, Lord. You're laughing. You can't say maybe 12 years ago you came to New Zealand, you ate a burger and you felt an anointing. Hey, could have been a burger that I prayed for. What is my point? My point is that you are where you are for God's plans and purposes to be outworked through your life. You may be the only Bible that people are going to get to read at your workplace, at your school, wherever it is. You know, don't complain to God for what you don't have. Thank him for what you have. Look around you. There's an opportunity to be a blessing. You know, this is only one way in which to preach the gospel. Am I right, Pastor Neville? The pulpit is, and it's a very small way in which to preach the gospel. You got a chance to preach the gospel wherever you are, in whatever you do. And for me, you know, learning that experience in New Zealand was through the story of Joseph. Because I said to God, okay, fine, I'm here, but why? And God gave me these words, from the pit to the palace. And they became the words of my first book that I wrote. And he said, what I did for Joseph, I'm going to do for you. You know, the people that threw Joseph in the pit were his neighbors? No, his own brothers. I'll let you into a little secret. The guys that I sold my business to and didn't pay me were my family. Now, I know your family, everything is fine. There's no problems, nothing at all. And the other secret was these guys were Christian people. Now, I know Christian people in Pretoria are all honest people. They don't do anything wrong, but it was a lesson for me to learn that I could only trust in God and that problems would come your way. But what do you do? You know, and through the story of Joseph, I had to learn as well. The biggest lesson in Joseph is to forgive people and move on. And I had to learn that lesson. And I'm glad that I did that. Otherwise, I could not move ahead if I had not done that. But you know, my favorite verse in the Bible, I have many, many favorite ones, but my favoritest book or favorite verse in the Bible is Genesis 50:20. You know, it's a time when Joseph is now the prime minister of Egypt. He's now in the position of authority. And his brothers come before him and they are in a famine. They're looking for food. Joseph recognizes them, but they don't recognize him. And they come in front of him. And he says to them, I am Joseph. Can you imagine how scared his brothers would have been? Because now Joseph is the prime minister. He could have clicked his fingers and the guards could have killed these guys. Probably a bit wet under where they were standing as well. But Joseph looks at them through the eyes of God. And he says to them these words, powerful words. Because your brothers couldn't understand, but we thought we destroyed your dreams, you know. How is it that you're there now? And Joseph said, what you intended for evil, God has turned it around for good, for the saving of many lives. And that's what you got to understand. All the trials, all the persecutions, all the problems that you've gone through in your life can only get meaning through Jesus Christ. Can only get meaning through God's word, the living word that took upon flesh and came and lived amongst us. You know, other people, what they'll tell you, that's your karma. But you know, a little bit of insight I shared, I didn't share this with our morning service. But Pastor Neville, do you know that in the ancient Hebrew text, the Vedas, there's only one ultimate payment for your karma? It's written. It says the ultimate payment for one's karma is when a man dies on a tree. And some 2,000 years ago, the man died on the tree, the cross of Calvary. And if you're walking around and you're carrying this guilt and this burden of failure, of rejection, that you're not good enough, or people have done you down, and there's a monkey on your back that you need to get off, you know, God is saying to you, he is here today. His presence is here. All you got to do is lay it at his feet. You know, Hinduism is all about doing things. And the world teaches you that. When you believe that you got to be the man, you got to be the woman, you got to be the answer, the solution to your problems, then you walk around in this performance mentality that I'm only accepted if I do. I've got to do this, I've got to do that, I've got to do, 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 and then I end up in a whole lot of do-do. Because that's what happens when you try to save your own self. You know the Christianity, what Jesus says from the cross, what he says, it is done. It is done. It is finished. And all you got to do is you got to come before him. And that's sometimes a bit too hard for people to comprehend. You mean to say I don't have to do anything? No, no, no. ABC. Accept, believe, and confess. That is all. And for me, learning this took me through the trials. It took me to the pit, to the palace. You know, I wrote this book in New Zealand. I finished it in the end of 2006. I was interviewed on TV, but by that time, I was friends with former All Blacks and current All Blacks. And they were learning, I was learning rugby from them, and they were learning from me the scriptures. And we became good friends, and Ironi Clark wrote the foreword to that book, and Inga Tuigimala wrote the last word. And Inga Tuigimala was known as Inga the Winger. After I wrote that book, I wrote another book, and then Inga calls me around the beginning of 2009. And he was asked by Penguin Books to write his book. They gave him a list of 7 authors. And he looks at his wife, and his wife looks at him, and they said to them, we'll get back to you. They go home, and he says to his wife, you know what, I'm not comfortable with these guys writing my book. And his wife says to him, me too, me neither. And he says to who do you think I should get to write the book? And guess who she says? Mayan Subrayan. And guess what Enga says? Yeah, I was thinking the same. You know, we got to understand that God has not called us to be successful. He's called us to be faithful. And that's the answer that Mother Teresa gave when Senator Hatfield went to observe the work that she was doing in Calcutta. And when he looked and he saw the vast, immense amount of help that these people needed, he was distraught. And he looked at Mother Teresa and he says, how do you expect to be successful? And she turned around and she said to him, my dear Senator, God has not called me to be successful. He has called me to be faithful. Because when you're faithful in a little, Jesus says he will bless you with much. And that's the principle that I've lived by. And that's the principle that I teach. We want success in life, we've got to be faithful. Save, you know, minister to people that are around you. Help them through the weakness that you have. You know, with the Lions rugby, I started off in this church here, 2012 November. I was asked to be a speaker here, and Johan Ackerman, who isn't part of this church, was here, and I shared my story, and Johan Ackerman came up to me and he said, you know, would you like to come and help out at the Lions? We're going through a bit of a problem. We've been relegated from Super Rugby. Can you come and help? And I said, yeah, I'll do that. And I began a journey with the Lions from January 2013. And before I went there, I said, Lord, what can I share with these guys? Give me a rhema word. Give me a sure word that I can share with them. My first words were to the Lions were these three words: rejection, direction, resurrection. From our greatest rejection comes our greatest direction that God can use for our resurrection. You know, and I want to encourage you. Maybe you're in that place now. You're in that place of rejection. Seek first the kingdom of God. You've seen that scripture, Pastor Neville put it up. When you seek first the kingdom of God, you get direction. And when you are obedient and you are faithful to the call that God has given you, you will receive your resurrection. And it's important to remember that. And that's what I said to the lions. I said to them, I said, you're not in a good place now. People have criticized you. People have said, that's it. It's the end of the lions. 2013 is going to be your worst year. And I said to them, 2013 is going to be your best year. Because what was intended for evil, God can turn it around for good. And I wasn't just talking about success on the rugby field. I was talking about success for their lives. Because I said to them, I said, I'm not here to talk to you about success. I'm here to talk to you about failure. Because when you can fail well, then you will move forward in life. But the truth of the matter is that you're going to fail more in life than you're going to succeed. But how do you deal with the failure? Because if you don't overcome that failure, then you're going to be stuck there. But that is why you learn that the only failure in life is not to try. And how do you communicate that is important. Now, the words that you speak are important. And we got to know that, like Ezekiel, when God showed him the dry bones, God taught him a lesson that you got to prophesy life into those dry bones. Over your situation, over your circumstances, over your relationships, over your loved ones. What are you speaking? Are you speaking life or are you speaking death? Proverbs 18:21 says that we've got the power of life and death. And where is that? In your tongue. At that Daniel conference last year, I got my children to come up in front of about 4,000 Sturubura men. And we taught them a thing or two from God's word. We've got a family declaration that we share most times. And at that Daniel conference, we did that. And I believe the video clip is here. I want you to have a look at this this declaration. It's our family declaration, and it's available in my book, Boer Maak 'n Plan, as well, so if you're interested.
So speak life.
En ons doen 'n gesinsverklaring. En die gesinsverklaring wat ons doen is om lewe te spreek. En ons het 'n gesinsverklaring. En hulle sal vir hulle hierdie verklaring leer. Dis ons sobrien verklaring. En hierdie is Tabitha, say hello for the people. Okay, and Wayora.
Hello.
Hi.
Okay. Now, dis ons gesinsverklaring. So, Tabitha, can you begin, please? Nice and loud.
I am valuable. I am loved. God had a great plan for my life. I have favor wherever I go. God's blessings are chasing me down and overtaking me.
Father, I thank you that you call me to be the head and not the tail. I'm above and not beneath. You said that I'll be able to lend money and not borrow. You said whatever I put my hands to do shall prosper. So Father, I thank you that I'm blessed and I cannot be cursed. I am excited about today. This is the day that you have made and I will rejoice and be glad in it. I thank you in advance for your blessings, favor, and victory in my life today.
I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Philippians 4:13. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Psalm 23 verse 6. With long life, God satisfies my soul and shows me salvation. Psalm 91 verse 16. No weapon formed against me shall prosper, and every word that rises up against me I shall condemn, as is my inheritance as a servant of the Lord. Isaiah 54:17. God's plans are to give me a hope and a future and not to harm me. Their plans for good and not for evil. Jeremiah 29:11. My God shall supply all my needs according to his riches and glory. Philippians 4:19. God can do exceedingly, abundantly, and above all I could imagine or think. Ephesians 3:20. Amen.
ek het vir hulle gesê dat ons is op pad hemel toe. En ek het vir die kinders gesê dat ons, as ons in die hemel is, ons moet die hemelse taal gebruik. En ons is hier net vir 18 maanden. En Afrikaans is een foreign taal vir hulle. Hulle is gebore in New Zealand. En hulle kom na Suid-Afrika, maar ek het vir hulle een uitdaging gegee.
So here's my children doing it in Afrikaans. This is what shocked the guys.
Peter, can you begin?
They weren't expecting this.
Ek is waardevol, ek is gemind. God het een groot plan vir my leven. Ek is gewild waar ek oor gaan gaan. God te sien gaan, al my in en loop my vooruit.
Vader, dankie dat jy my geroep het om te kop te wees en nie die staat nie. Ek vlug boe en kryp nie onderrond nie. Jy het gesê dat ek in staat sal wees om vergeer aarde as om te ontvang. Jy het gesê dat alles wat ek oog al aanpak sal floreer.
Vader, ek is opgewonde oor vandag. Dit is die dag deur jy gemaak. Ek gaan sing en bly wees. Dankie by voorbaat vir die sienige guns en voorspoed wat ek vandag in my lewe gaan ervaar.
Amen. And that's the lesson I think we all can receive and put our hands up and say, yeah. Because my question to you is like how God presented those dry bones to Ezekiel in the natural. And what do you see for South Africa? What's the future that you see for South Africa? Do you see just as it is in the corruption and in the crime and in all things that are wrong? And is that what you're going to describe? You know, I believe that we don't just use words to describe our situation, but you use God's word to change the situation. A position of hopelessness for Ezekiel with the dry bones was changed to life. And we got the power of life and death in our tongue. And I want to encourage you. You know, South Africa belongs to God. And whenever we speak anything negative about South Africa, how do you think God feels? You know, even over your situation and even your circumstances, you know, I want you to know that God has given you the power to change that, and that comes through His Word. I've asked Pastor Neville in the first service if he could lead us with the declaration, and I'm going to ask him again, please, if you could lead us with the declaration. I'd like you all to declare these words over, not just over South Africa, over your lives, over your situation, your loved ones.
Let's stand together. I appreciate what Mayan was sharing, because if you don't believe in the future of this country, you're not speaking positively, you're not making a positive confession, you're always complaining. What I remember about the Jews is complaining in the desert year after year. Most of them died like flies complaining. And regardless of the situation, let's join in and learn this from this family and confess this together with me. Let's start at the top. But I want you to turn to somebody and just say to that person, watch your words. Okay. Wonderful. Let's confess this together. I am valuable. I'm going to read it with me. I am loved. God has a great plan for my life. I have favor wherever I go. God's blessings are chasing me down and overtaking me. Father, I thank you that you called me to be the head and not the tail. I'm above and not beneath. You said that I will be able to lend money and not borrow. You said that whatever I put my hands to do shall prosper. So, Father, I thank you that I am blessed. I cannot be cursed. Father, I'm excited about today. This is the day that you've made. I'm going to rejoice and be glad in it. I thank you in advance for your blessings, favor and victory in my life today. Let's give the Lord a praise offering. Yeah. Wonderful. Wonderful. As we close this service, I just want you to know, if Chuck will just come and stand here with me. The English, this is an English congregation. It's not a service. want you to know that we're a family. And we're going to grow together as a family. Now and then, Chuck will be ministering in the morning. And in the evening, there will be services in the chapel in English. And we'll go together as a family. But we need your constant prayer. We need your support. We need your contributions. We need you to be faithful. And then, as together as a team, we can do it. Now, on Wednesday night... on Wednesday night, the 26th, we have a funky hat night. The thing didn't work at the back, so you couldn't see Chuck and all of us in hats. But we'll see you at that time. Otherwise, we continue Sunday after Sunday. And tonight, mine will be ministering in Afrikaans. But now and then, we'll have Chuck will even minister in the English, in the Afrikaans service. Because we need to build together as a family. Okay. Wonderful. We're going to conclude with the chorus we started with in the beginning. God is fighting for us. I want you to know, but God fights for you through your tongue.